Okay, well, welcome to the sixth meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies today, and we are joined remotely by Pam Gossel and Fulton McGregor, and Fulton will be joining us in person shortly. The first agenda item is to agree whether to take items 4 and 5 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence and consideration of our work programme. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
That is agreed. Thank you. Moving on to agenda item 2, which is the proposed Right to Food Scotland Bill evidence session. And I welcome to the meeting Rhoda Grant, MSP, and Nick Hawthorne, Senior Assistant Clerk from the Scottish Parliament's Non-Government Bills Unit. You're both very, very welcome. I refer members to papers 1 and 2. We also have correspondence from 4 individuals asking that the draft proposal be allowed to proceed to the next stage, and a letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, which sets out the Scottish Government's position. So I therefore invite Rhoda to make a short opening statement before we move to questions.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to appear before the committee today to discuss the statement of reasons accompanying my draft proposal for a Right to Food Scotland Bill. And it's maybe quite fitting that we're talking about this in Challenge Poverty Week. The committee is being asked to determine whether it's content with the statement of reasons, which sets out why I consider it unnecessary to carry out a consultation on my proposal. My proposal is effectively the same proposal that was lodged by Elaine Smith in the last session to incorporate a right to food into Scots law. And Elaine Smith obtained the right to introduce a bill, but there wasn't enough time left in the last session for her to do so. The consultation on her proposal ran for 12 weeks and received responses from a wide range of individuals and organisations from different sectors and backgrounds. The individual responses and a summary of responses is available publicly online. That's available to the committee, and I believe they have probably seen that. I believe the variety of responses to the consultation from the public and other stakeholders across Scotland remain relevant to my proposal, as do the many other studies and papers on the right to food that have been published. Repeating the consultation process for what is in effect the same proposal for legislation that was consulted on by Elaine Smith, I believe would be an unnecessary duplication of work, particularly given that that consultation only closed little over a year ago. And I think that timescale fits with other bills as well. Therefore, I hope the committee agrees that a further consultation would not be required in this instance. And I'm happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
That's great. Thank you very much. The committee will be aware that our role today isn't to say whether we agree with the proposal or not. It's about the statement of reasons. And for me, there are two things which I think we have to be satisfied before agreeing to set aside the normal process that a member would follow in terms of consulting prior to bringing forward a bill. And two things would be that, for me, that the previous consultation was robust, and secondly, that the previous consultation remains relevant. So I'm going to ask some questions, Rhoda, in relation to the robustness of the consultation. Quite a low number, overall number of responses. I've kind of seen lots of stuff flying around in terms of percentages, but the actual number of responses are quite low. In terms of your statement of reasons, it talks about 225 organisations contacted. And I wonder if you could give us a bit of a breakdown about what those organisations were. So any thoughts on why the number was so low comparative to other consultations? Certainly on an issue that seems really relevant, it seems like a low number to me. And a breakdown on the organisations which were proactively contacted by the previous member.
Okay. I wouldn't suggest the number of responses are particularly low. 71 people on behalf of organisations, and 181 individuals responded. So I would say that was reasonable, but you also need to bear in mind that this consultation followed on from the Good Food Nation consultation, where a number of the people who responded to that talked about this proposal and indeed recommended this proposal. I think around a third of them did that. So I think once people have responded to one and made their points very clear, and, you know, if you're looking at a members bill, if you're looking at a government bill, obviously people are looking, expect the government to bring forward legislation, whereas maybe members' legislation they're not so sure of. So I think that would account for that. My understanding is Elaine Smith put her consultation round a number of public bodies, so local authorities, health boards, as well as the trade union movement and stakeholders who are very interested in this proposal. So I think she made sure that it was out there and well received, but not everybody, not every health board, not every local council would respond to such a consultation, but some did and responded very positively.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, in fact, two-thirds of those that were specifically targeted didn't respond. That seems like a particular, given that you're highlighting organisations who you think might be particularly interested, two-thirds didn't respond. Do you want to comment on that?
Well, as I said, a number of those bodies were health boards, were statutory bodies who possibly weren't seeing this as number one priority given the time, so wouldn't have responded and would have maybe expected others to do that on their behalf.
You don't think the pandemic, given that the consultation was carried out in the middle of the pandemic, at the height of the pandemic, in fact, would have made it difficult for some of those organisations to respond because they were working in a different way?
Not necessarily. I think policy people would have been working from home, like many of us were, and possibly would have had more time to look at this. But given that the consultation to the Good Food Nation Bill had happened as well, they had maybe put that in. That's on the record. So why repeat a process?
OK, thank you. We will move around the table. Maggie, do you want to kick off?
Thanks very much. And Rhoda, thank you for coming along this morning to talk to this. I'm interested just to explore, following on from Joe's questions, just the relationship between your proposed bill and the other things that we know are happening in this coming year. So there's commitment to introduce the Good Food Nation Bill this year. But also the incorporation of other treaties which include the right to food into Scots law as part of the Human Rights Bill later on in the session. I just wondered if you had any thoughts or comments on that.
Yes, I'm aware that those pieces of legislation have been promised. The Good Food Nation Bill was promised last session and has been held across to this session. The government have said that they wouldn't be incorporating this into the Good Food Nation Bill. I think they've made that quite clear. They're looking at it more in terms of their Human Rights Bill. But it's not clear to me whether, as part of the Human Rights Bill, they would have the vehicle for delivery, which is part of this bill. So what will happen if the committee decide that I can proceed with a bill based on the previous consultation is that once I table a bill, the government have the opportunity, if they're going to legislate in that way, to take over the bill. So there is nothing lost. They can go ahead and do that. But if they weren't looking to have a vehicle for implementation, then the bill would go forward and obviously government could comment on it at that stage.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Pam Gossel. Okay. Pam, can you hear us? Okay, we'll go to Karen, then we'll come back to Pam. Karen.
Thank you. Good morning, Rhoda. I'd just like to ask, you touched upon, intentions of the Scottish Government there, and I was just wondering if you've had any discussions yourself with the Scottish Government in regards to their intentions around any of this in regards to policy.
I've had discussions with the previous Cabinet Secretary for Rural about the Good Food Nation Bill, because I was very interested in that bill and whether it would bring forward these commitments within it. So I've had those discussions in the last... Sorry. I'm croaking at you. I've had those discussions in the last session. I haven't had any formal discussions in this session, but obviously I've been putting down questions and trying to get more information. But I suppose the way I work is I'm happy to work with government and would look forward to working with government on this proposal, seeing what they're doing and how we can work together. I think most people are agreed that in a country as rich as ours that has the food supplies, is actually so proud of what we, our food and what we deliver, that nobody should be going hungry, no one should be going without food. And I think we can all sign up to that aim, and I would be very happy to work with government to try and realise those aims. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And moving back to Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, my question follows on from yours. And good morning, Rhoda. It's in relation to now that the fact that, you know, we're hoping we're kind of getting over COVID, so we're in a very different place now. And I think it's about that you've talked about that you don't need no further consultation, but don't you think it would benefit talking to these organisations again, because this was over a year ago?
I don't think so. I think given the government's consultation, given Elaine Smith's consultation, and the statement of reasons goes over a fair amount of ground where this has been discussed before, I think legislation has come forward with much less consultation and many fewer responses to consultation, and that has been good legislation as well. So I think it has been well consulted on, and I think to have another consultation simply would delay action. And I think if the pandemic has shown us anything, it is the need for a right to food in Scotland, because we saw people going hungry. Even when people were isolating due to COVID, just having those things in place that made sure they were able to eat. And in the last fortnight, we've heard of the very sad case of a pensioner starving to death in Scotland. I don't think we can afford to delay. I mean, this is costing lives and life chances, because we know that young people growing up without an adequate diet end up with huge health issues that we all pay for down the line. So we see malnutrition, we see obesity being huge problems facing us right here, right now, that we should be dealing with. And if anything, the pandemic has delayed legislation in this area, and I don't think we can afford to delay it any further.
Okay. Okay, Pam. Pam Duggan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Rhoda. The statement of reasons highlights the extensive consultation that was carried out in the last session through official consultation and the Cooperative Party's email and targeted campaign, and 93% of respondents were in favour. So do you think that the majority support during the last consultation would still be reflective of public opinion? If you think there's a change, what would it be? And what would the effect of a delay be? What would the effect of a delay be on this legislation?
I should refer members to my register of interest. I'm a member of the Co-op Party, who are very, very keen on this proposal. And indeed, I'm not only working with the Co-op Party, but I'm working with stakeholders who have been consulted on this. So I've had meetings with and invited those who responded to the bill previously and met with them on a reasonably regular basis. Of those people, there was a number who wanted to become much more involved. So we have a steering committee set up with organisations and individuals who are very keen to see this proposal go forward. And so I'm working very closely with them. So I've been in touch with those who have responded to the consultation, and they are still incredibly keen. There was one of them, and I should remember this, consulted recently, took some polling, and the overwhelming support within the public of this bill coming forward was there for all to see. So I think public opinion, and if anything, I think the pandemic showed people that food was not something we all take for granted in a way, is food. Many people during the pandemic realised that couldn't be taken for granted. So we had times when people were afraid to be tested because they were afraid that they were going to have to isolate and wouldn't have food. So suddenly people began to realise that and live, I suppose, other people's day-to-day experience of where am I getting my next meal? And I think, if anything, that has moved up in the public consciousness the right to food. So I think it's still as important, if not more important now, to have that right to food. And I think the effect of consulting, again, is just the effect of delaying. You know, we should have done this in the last session of Parliament. That's what people expected, and that's, but the pandemic slowed that down and stopped that happening. So I think if we owe anything to those who were hungry during the pandemic, it's to make sure that we now have the right processes in place to make sure people are fed.
Thank you.
Okay. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Rhoda, for coming today. And I think we need to pay tribute to Elaine Smith for what she did in the past, and I want to make that on the record today. And thank you for taking on the role that you're now doing. When it comes to the consultation, we've already heard today that, in your opinion, that you believe that that is enough and that it's gone out to a large number of individuals and organisations. And we've also heard about the human rights bill that's coming forward and the Good Food Nation bill. But where do you see the whole process moving? And do you see there being resource implications depending on how things develop? Because there are now going to be other organisations and other bills and things taking part in all of this. And where do you see that fitting in the process?
Because I am not entirely clear how the Scottish Government intend to bring forward their human rights bill, it's not clear if they will have a vehicle within that bill for delivery, because people could argue that human rights are all our rights, they're already there, but we still have people that don't have a right to food in our country. So the bill is really designed not only to enshrine the human right of the right to food in Scottish legislation, it's there to provide a vehicle for the delivery, because it's the delivery that is hugely important. So I'm not very clear. I suppose if you were to push me my and why I was speaking to the Scottish Government in the last session was I would have liked to have seen this at the heart of a Good Food Nation bill, because we invest £100 million in our food system. Already huge amounts of public money are going into the food system. And what I'm hearing from organisations that represent food workers and within that system, that the people who produce, and usually the frontline producers of food, are the people who are going hungry. So you're producing the food, but you still don't have a right to food. So I would have wanted to see that in the heart of the Good Food Nation bill, but I believe this bill, with a vehicle for delivery, would work alongside all, because it's not one thing, it's not a tick box. This is going to take some time to implement and to change, because our food system is so disjointed, and I think that's why everyone's been calling out for a Good Food Nation bill, not only to show our natural resource and highlight what we have, but to also make sure that the way we produce food doesn't leave people behind. And I think it's very much part of that. So that would be my preference, but that doesn't look like it's possible. So I would hope that if we have this, then that would work alongside a Good Food Nation bill and the changes to our food system to make sure that everybody has a right to food. I'm sorry, that was maybe a bit, a long way round to a short answer. Apologies.
Okay, thank you.
Just following on from the points that you're making there, we've received a letter from the Cabinet Secretary making very clear that it's her view that this would be very central to the wider human rights work And I note from the consultation, a number of the respondents to Elaine Smith's consultation did make the point that they felt that rather than this being taken forward in isolation, it should be part of a wider human rights approach and in terms of that wider legislation. Do you think that makes a huge difference now that we have a manifesto commitment, which is then in an agreement between the Scottish Government and the Green Party, and now re-emphasised by the Cabinet Secretary in the letter that we've received, that makes a significant difference to what was consulted on over a year ago when none of those things were in place, that we've now got certainty that this is something that the Government will be taking forward?
I'll come to Nick just about the process points, and I don't think anything I'm proposing today, if the Government are wishing to bring forward this bill and in another form, or certainly make sure that the aims of this bill are met through their human rights bill, that this today approving the right to go forward without another consultation wouldn't interfere with that. Nick, can I just get you to cover the process?
Of course. Good morning. Yes, I mean, nothing affects what the Scottish Government can or will decide to do in that sense. Should you approve the statement today, Rhoda would then have the right to introduce a final proposal, which is the one-month period that she seeks the support from 18 other members from at least two parties to earn the right to introduce a bill. And at that stage, the Government has a formal right to indicate that they will legislate within 2 years to deliver the terms of Rhoda's final proposal.
I guess that wasn't actually my question. My question was whether the fact that the Government have made that commitment in such clear terms, both in relation to the agreement with the Green Party, between the Scottish Government and the Green Party, and in terms of the letter from the Cabinet Secretary, whether that changes things and actually, in the light of that, folks should be able to say whether they think that your bill should go ahead in the light of knowing the knowledge of what the Government proposal is.
Okay, I think just referring back to what Nick said, approving the statement of reasons and allowing this to go forward today doesn't interfere in any way whatsoever with that. But what you're asking me is why am I pursuing this? Because you believe the Scottish Government is doing it. The reason I am pursuing this is I know the Scottish Government have said that they will enshrine human rights into Scottish law. What I am not so clear about is whether they will provide a vehicle to make sure that those human rights are implemented. So this bill does both. It not only enshrines in Scottish law the human right to food, it also provides a vehicle to oversee the implementation of that. And that's the bit that I am not entirely clear about. But as Nick said, if the Government are quite clear about that and that's what they want to do, they can take over this bill. This doesn't affect them. And I suppose that with the complexity of the food system, this, in a way, it would be better if they did, because they can make this bill move in ways that probably I, as a member, cannot. They can tie it up much better. They can do much more complex legislation. So, I am not doing it to try and beat them to it. I am trying to make sure it happens. And if they decide they're going to do it, then they will have me cheering them on and happily handing over the proposal to them.
It does feel like an area that you would kind of hope that the Parliament could work together. My point wasn't really the one that you've picked up. It was more about relevance of the consultation before. Has anything changed? And I guess my point is that those commitments are what's changed. But I think you've kind of maybe answered as much as you might want to on that area. Okay. Unless there's anybody further wanting to contribute. The process now, thanks very much to the member for her evidence. I hope we weren't too challenging in our questioning. I know it's a hugely different experience being at the other side of the table. We are required to make a decision on whether we are satisfied by the statement of reasons, or whether we are not satisfied. And I remind members that our decision should be based on whether we agree that the member has a statement of reasons, that no further consultation on the proposal is necessary or not, and we're not deliberating on whether we agree or disagree with the principle of the bill. That would be for a later stage, depending on the outcome of today. So the question is the committee satisfied by the statement of reasons? Given that we have a member remotely, I would be proposing to call each member in turn to indicate whether they are satisfied or not by the statement of reasons. So just for clarity, if members are satisfied with the statement of reasons, I would ask them to vote yes. If they are not satisfied, I would ask them to vote no, or otherwise to abstain. So I will go around the room, starting with Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Joe, for that. I'm not satisfied, no.
Okay. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. No, I'm not satisfied.
Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. I realise I've just come in. I have been following proceedings on Blue Jeans. Am I able to... I don't know, technically speaking, am I able to make a comment?
You can make a comment prior to voting, yes.
Yeah. So I want to thank Rhoda Grant for taking the bill forward. Sorry, I'm still out of breath running up the stairs. And I want to pay tribute also to Elaine Smith for the work that she'd done in the previous Parliament on this. I did support the last bill as a declaration of interest. I did sign up to supporting of the bill, and I'm still very supportive of its aims. Having followed what's been said today, I'm also clear that the government have written to the committee and said that they are keen to bring forward a bill as part of the overall human rights bill, as well as the Good Food Nation bill. So I do feel that is a pretty significant change in circumstances. And I also feel that the cooperation deal between the SNP and the Green Party has propelled that further forward. So I do think there has been a significant change in circumstances. And with a degree of reluctance at this stage, I'm inclined to vote not satisfied.
Okay, thank you. Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Convener. I'm wanting to vote yes.
Okay, thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I am satisfied, both in terms of the consultation being comprehensive and also not asking organisations who consulted before and putting more pressure on them to do so again at this time. So I am satisfied with the statement of reasons and vote yes.
Okay. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I am also satisfied with the statement of reasons and will vote yes.
Okay, thank you. I think on balance that gives us three votes for satisfied and four votes for not satisfied with the statement of reasons, and the committee is therefore not satisfied with the statement of... Sorry, I haven't voted. I am also not satisfied, but on balance I do think there is a good piece of work to go ahead, and I think it's an area of work that this committee will clearly have a particular interest. I'm keen to encourage the member to engage with the government going forward, but obviously it is up to the member to consult if she sees fit and bring back another proposal. That would be within the rules if she deemed fit. My vote is for not satisfied. So that would therefore be four votes for not satisfied and three votes for satisfied. So the committee is therefore not satisfied with the statement of reasons. That concludes our consideration of this item. I thank Rhoda and Nick for attending, and I'll suspend the meeting briefly. kick off and just, you know, just take your time. So the next item on the agenda is to take evidence on pre-budget scrutiny. We'll hear from two panels of witnesses today. So I welcome to the meeting our first panel of witnesses, and one of our witnesses is joining us virtually. So I welcome virtually Alison Everson, President of COSLA, and in person Nina Mundy, Chief Executive, Fife Centre for Equalities, and Paul Bradley, Policy and Public Affairs for the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations. You're all very, very welcome. I refer members to papers 3 and 4, and thank all of the members for your helpful written submissions, and invite you each to make a short opening statement, starting with Councillor Everson, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me to speak to the committee today. Local government is the anchor in our communities and for our most vulnerable groups, for children, young people and families, for the elderly and those needing support, for our most marginalised communities and the people we are welcoming in, for local businesses, for those needing help with housing, and for the services that protect and improve our physical and emotional well-being and the environment. We work with diverse communities and local organisations every day to bring about change, to respect human rights and equalities, to embed local democracy, and to enable the voices of people to be heard. Local government is indeed the key partner to achieve rights realisation across Scotland. It is therefore critical in the context of human rights realisation that local government is given a fair settlement to support this. Since 2013-14, local government's revenue budget has reduced by 2.1% in real terms, while the Scottish Government's budget increased by 2.3% over the same period. While local government has itself protected areas of the budget, such as social work and education, as much as possible, this means that cuts to other areas such as culture and leisure have been higher, and this has had an impact on rights realisation and the well-being of our communities. We need a holistic approach to the services delivered by local government: social care, education, housing, employability, leisure, transport, the local environment, as together they support the rights of the individual. There must be clear links between the budget, the programme for government and the national performance framework for rights realisation. In addition to a fair settlement, Scottish Government should empower local government to raise revenue to ensure that there are maximum available resources which can be used by local government to support our communities. In particular, the council tax freeze should be dropped, as it does not help those that need it most. Other areas that can be explored, including the tourist tax, setting planning and building control fees locally to enable full cost recovery. We should be continuing to work together on the three empowerments of the local governance review: fiscal, functional and community. Scottish Government should therefore be using the opportunities of human rights budgeting to enable and empower the public sector to support rights realisation and avoid the regression of rights. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I go to Paul Bradley?
Of course. Good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me along today. It's been 2 years, I think, since I was last in front of this committee as part of its pre-budget inquiry back in 2019. And back then, the committee had recognised the clear need to investigate how the third sector was coping under tougher financial conditions, and recognising the vital role that voluntary organisations play in the delivery of equalities and human rights outcomes. Not one of us sitting around this table, although I think some new faces now, knew what was to unfold in the months and years ahead. I would say even today, following the pandemic, that committee's report from 2019 still rings true. The sector still longs to see much of what was in that report, from longer-term funding models, simplified application and bidding processes, reducing the competitive nature of procurement models, greater participation in the budget process, and stronger partnerships between the public sector and voluntary sector across the board. On the one hand, 2 years on, there has been much to learn and build upon from what the pandemic has unearthed. It has shone a light on how invaluable the voluntary sector is. It absolutely has stepped up to deliver vital services in communities that the public sector would not have been able to deliver on its own. And though not universal, we've seen some fantastic examples of partnership working between the voluntary sector and public sector. And the public sector has leveraged the skills, knowledge and experience of voluntary organisations in many cases. And we've also seen far greater flexibility in existing and new funding arrangements. Many public sector funders, but also independent funders, flexed their models and worked and encouraged the sector to get money to where it was needed most. We also saw the Scottish Government work with voluntary sector bodies to develop co-design emergency funding models with SCVO and many others. And there was clear trust in the sector to get money to where it was needed most. On the other hand, 2 years on, and the pandemic has only served to exacerbate the challenges that voluntary organisations have faced for many years. And those challenges are the ones that the committee heard about back in 2019, but particularly in relation to the sustainability of voluntary sector funding, which has been highlighted for many years and most recently by the Advisory Group on Economic Recovery and Scotland Social Renewal Advisory Board. And the emergency funding for the sector during the pandemic has been a lifeline and it's kept organisations afloat, and there is no doubt about that. But one-off payments like that are no substitute for longer-term sustainable funding models for the sector. And I think over the coming years, this committee will hear about the challenges that voluntary organisations face with their funding. And I just want to be clear that that might have been worsened by the pandemic, but the pandemic isn't the root cause. These are challenges that voluntary organisations have faced for many years. So to finish, I think the sector has been clear on what changes are the most useful next steps in relation to funding and partnership working, both before the pandemic and right now. It's also been clear on some of the big social and economic policy changes that are needed, and I think that's been neatly captured in the report of the Social Renewal Advisory Board. And I think for progress to be made on all of these areas, it's absolutely vital that governments alone are not orchestrating these changes. The voluntary sector must be welcome to play a crucial role in attempts to positively change the operating environment for the sector and in design and delivery of national and local outcomes in delivering equalities and human rights. And I hope the committee, through its work on pre-budget scrutiny, but also through the rest of its work programme, will ensure that it's not just policy change that we see, but there is a clear and obvious involvement of the sector in how those changes are designed and implemented. Thank you.
Thank you. And Nina.
Thank you very much for inviting me here today. It is my first time ever being speaking to a committee setting, so thank you very much. And do tell me if I'm not following the rule. I think both the speakers have kind of very much said some of the things that we've already submitted. So I'm going to keep my statement to be really short, because I think what my statement is probably echoing some of the councillor and also from SCVO. But then I think our main focus is about decentralising the funding. For equality initiatives, we believe that there needs to be ring-fenced funding allocated to local authorities for local distributions. Currently, the equality and human rights grants are administered by the Scottish Government. The majority of the recipients are national organisations based in the central belt or main cities in Scotland. Equality is a matter that needs to be addressed at every corner of Scotland, and everybody should have the rights for all the human rights and everything else. And then earlier the conversation about the food and the human rights of food, I would echo that actually. We need to consider what do we mean by human rights. Just by providing the same food for everybody is not meeting human rights. I mean, during the pandemic, Five Centre for Equalities, with some of the funding from SCVO and other partners, we were able to distribute culturally sensitive food parcels to older people that they choose the food themselves. And I think if we're talking about human rights, we need to think of that kind of level. So back to my... So it is important that people with protected characteristics feel they can thrive and fulfil a good quality of life at where they live, rather than feeling that they need to move or travel to cities to access more appropriate services. And investment for local preventative projects that foster good relations is really important
to foster good relations between different protected characteristics and assist these groups to utilise their rights. And Fife Centre for Equalities actually is a very, very good example of how a local initiative that bring together communities of different protected characteristics, because I think sometimes we have the Equality Act 2010, but we're constantly segregating people into a box, whereas I think Fife Centre for Equalities, we challenge that. We bring people together. We have Fife Equalities Forum that have representatives from disability, and we're not talking about individuals, we're talking about organisations that working with people with disabilities, working with transgender, working with women issues, working, minority ethnic communities, the whole range. But we meet together once a month, the organisations, and to look at what the common issues. So I think, if anything, do use Fife Centre for Equalities as a good example of local investment that by a local authority, Fife Council, to create an umbrella organisation that help delivering equality, helping the public authorities in Fife to deliver the public sector equality duties. And we, more importantly, we help build bridges on equality issues between the public sector partners and those who feel they have been disadvantaged. So, again, I would like to kind of just advocate that the investment locally is important, but also needs to be fairer as well. The assumption is that time and time again, initiatives that are based in cities somehow worth more than projects based in the region. So we employ the same amount of staff, and we need to be put in a position so that we are just as equally competitive. And investment in local regions is so important, because otherwise there's going to be, we're not going to have this fairer distribution if people are not given this chance to vote. Education, employment, transport, health, everything that you can think of within where actually they live.
Okay, thank you very much, Nina. And for a first appearance at committee, thanks very much, particularly for your passion. The committee is really keen to make sure that, as well as hearing from well-kent faces like Alison, that we hear from new voices like yourself. So thanks very much for coming along. And obviously, Paul's been to committee before, but thank you for your evidence too. So we'll now move to questions. I'm going to start just by setting out that the committee is on a bit of a journey. This is the first year that the committee has sought to particularly look at the budget through a human rights lens, and we're keen that this year isn't the end of that, but that we learn to do that better going forward. So be good to hear from yourselves whether either, obviously, both Paul and Alison represent organisations, and whether those organisations are managing to take a human rights approach, or what more they would need to be able to do that. And Nina, what your experience as an organisation is in relation to whether you think that the partners that you work with, whether that be third sector or Fife Council, are taking a human rights approach from your perspective. So why don't I start with Paul?
Of course. I think it goes without saying that the voluntary organisations are a key partner in the delivery of equalities and human rights outcomes. And I think the challenges that, for SCVO, we look at the challenges that voluntary organisations face across the board. We look at patterns and trends and the challenges and try to identify potential solutions. I think what voluntary organisations want to do most is do what their mission says, and about working with people, working with communities to deliver the best outcomes possible. But I think one of the biggest challenges that I would say has come up in the calls that I've had through interviews recently with charity CEOs and senior leaders is this constant cycle of trying to find replacement funding on a year-to-year basis. Organisations use a lot of their capacity to find new funding, and it is a year-round process. So organisations will get funding through the door, they'll get the funding in the bank account, and then they'll have to start looking for funding for the next year because the concerns that funding will dry up for the following year. And I think it can be easier for large organisations to be able to manage that, and it's not easy, but I think it can be easier for large organisations to manage that if they've got funding officers who are skilled and able to identify new sources of funding and you know, create the best applications. But when we look at the majority of the voluntary sector, 4 out of 5 charities, registered charities in Scotland, have an income of less than £100,000. And I think about 3-4% of Scottish registered charities have an income of over £1 million. The majority are small organisations that don't have a funding officer, that don't have those skills in their teams. And then if we look at equalities organisations as well, many of those are specialists and are working on small budgets and don't have that capacity to be able to be chasing funding year round. And I think that the time that's spent looking for funding is time that's spent not working on services that the public sector has invested in voluntary organisations to deliver. If you don't have a funding officer, then it's the person who's delivering the services who is also writing applications to try and find new sources of funding. And that's just not sustainable and it doesn't work. And I think also another challenge, and it comes down to, I guess, equalities being pitted against each other, is that that annual cycle of funding also rubs up against the changing priorities of the day. And as things move up and down the agenda, organisations can find that their well-established services have to be stripped back slightly and scaled down or cut altogether. And that leads to people who are still in need in communities not being able to access the services that were set up in the first place to support them. And it can often cause more harm than good when it takes much longer than an annual cycle of funding to work with people to overcome some of the biggest challenges in their lives. And I think that that's really key. And then just to build on that quickly, I think those organisations that are lucky enough and fortunate enough to have to get their hands on longer term funding or, you know, an indicative agreement for longer term funding, often these organisations don't see an inflationary uplift for the years in which they are receiving those funds. And just give you one example, I spoke to an organisation recently that hadn't had an inflationary uplift from their local authority for 13 years. I'm not sure how anyone can expect an organisation to deliver the same scale services for the same money that they were given back in 2008. Thank you.
Thank you. Nina, do you want to?
I think, actually, given the recent example of the preparation for Afghan refugees in Fife, I think all the local partners have a very, very good understanding of human rights and equality. And especially when it comes to crisis like this, and also when you look at the whole rollout of the COVID vaccine, a whole range of partners working together to ensure that communities receive the messages and coming forward for the vaccine. But then it's the day-to-day process that often lack the voices of very much what Paul has spoken about, the smaller groups that they don't really have the dedicated staff, and it's, and they're trying to do their best for the user groups, and then there's every day there's more and more consultations that coming out from a national level and also local level, and you need, you know, local based groups that help people to respond to these consultations. Otherwise, their voices will remain unheard, because a lot of the consultations is still very much about how well you write in English, how well you understand. When you think about the amount of people who have communication needs, people with learning difficulties, people whose English is not their first language, people who just, you know, have difficulty of understanding written form or writing. And I mean, before coming in, we spoke to Paul, the whole funding application processes is still depending on how well you write, you know, how well you can tell your story. And then when you have smaller communities or smaller groups who rely on volunteers, with various commitments and all that, and they're not able to participate in that process. And then so you do need something that in between, like Fife Centre for Equalities, to help individuals to kind of like give them a voice, to ensure that they do have a voice in all the vital consultations. I mean, just to give you an example, that recently we helped Fife Council with the equality outcomes consultation. I mean, to my amazement, I mean, we received like 275 responses. That's during the pandemic, and people so people are passionate about equality, and we use things that you know, they can respond by WhatsApp or different, or just saying it in their own language. You know, so we have to be much more creative in terms of wanting to really understand how people feel about things. And so that, but then to do that, you have to have the local group somewhere that able to do that. And then we work with a range of partners. I mean, Fife Centre for Equalities, we can't possibly understand every community's needs. So we need to have equally those groups that working with people directly on the ground to be well supported financially, but then to compete with national organisations is just a very unfair system. You know, so that, again, if there's investment need to be made about equality and human rights, we need to look at how that's done within the local authorities level.
Okay, thank you very much. And Councillor Everson.
Yes, thank you very much. I recognise many of the challenges that the previous speakers have talked about and share their concerns about those. But I also very much welcome the journey the committee's on. I think it's really important to be on that journey. We've argued in previous years that the budget setting process needs to be based on the National Performance Framework and the Sustainable Development Goals within that. And of course, this is a step beyond and involving the community, the committee as it is in the budget setting, I think is welcome work. So thank you for that. Equality of human rights is obviously fundamental to what we do in local government. If you've come across the local government blueprint, and if you haven't, I refer that document to you. You'll see that in our vision for the future moving forward in local government right across Scotland in all its diversity, that human rights and equalities is central to that vision. I also think it's really important to think about the experience of the person, the individual within all this. And it's the combination of services that the council provides that are so important to an individual achieving their rights and equalities within that. It is not just housing or welfare payments or education or transport. It's everything together across the piece, meeting the needs of the individual if we really are going to support equalities and human rights in the way we want to. And that leads to the question of when the funding for local government is not adequate and councils across Scotland have to make choices about where they are allocating funding. Because in doing that and making a choice that is forced upon them because of the funding settlement means that, you know, equality and human rights somewhere are going to be impacted by that lack of choice, that lack of flexibility given to that council locally. And it's important it's given to that council locally because the needs right across Scotland, the experiences of our communities right across Scotland are very different from our urban areas to our villages to our islands, and that needs to be responded to in any settlement. But I also think that as we're trying to embed equalities and human rights in our communities, we need to think carefully, as the other speakers have done, about the funding that's made available. If we are going to be effective, we need to have the ability to do strategic long-term funding, which you can't do with single-year budgets. That multi-year budgeting is crucial to the strategic way going forward. Getting individual pots of money for individual projects can be effective short-term, but it does not help address the needs that we really want to address. It does not help councils in their planning and their moving forward, especially when these pots of money are associated with huge administrative burdens, which take council officers' time away from delivering services to filling in forms to hand back about outcomes on sometimes a very small amount of money. Nina has referred to the problems around bidding for money as well, and when you've got bid funds, you know, who are the ones that actually benefit from a bid fund? Is it putting money where it's actually needed? Is it actually addressing equalities and human rights in the best way? Or is it ensuring that money is going to the people that can fill in the forms in the timely manner, in the most articulate manner, rather than actually addressing needs for where we are going? So I think there's common issues here in the other speakers and the experiences as well of the SCVO and our voluntary partners who we have worked with tremendously during the pandemic. And at a local level, the partnerships that have been developed between a third sector and council have been tremendous and had good effect. But the problems they're experiencing, I recognise we have the same. We need to have flexibility in funding. We need to have long-term funding. We need to have an end to small pots of money. And we need to have an end to bid funding, which does not ensure that the money goes to the right places. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. These are really been really wide questions, so thanks for the responses. I think going forward, we're going to have to be a little bit sharper on both sides, so I'll take part of the blame for asking such a wide question there. Can I now move to Pam Gossel?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements, which have been very helpful today. Do you think that increased participation delivers better budgets, and what needs to be in place for it to be successful? I know that all of you have touched on this, but looking at what actually needs to be in place, and also what's your experience of creating and delivering opportunities for participation?
Okay, Nina, do you want to go first this time?
I think participation budgeting, if that's what you're referring to, I think it in theory it sounds like a good process, but a lot of the communities that we've been working with, they have been so marginalized. They have been so kind of like people just ignoring their needs because they simply don't have that kind of articulate voice that we've spoken about earlier, because they're not the type of people that tend to complain about lack of services. And then so when you then approach them to say what you think is best to spend the money, they wouldn't be able to tell you straight away. Because that ongoing engagement, that needs to be there all the time, you know. And I mean, that's something that Five Centre for Equalities and Five Council, we've already agreed that we're going to be working on that together for the next 4 years. Because I think people do want to participate in the decision making, but not necessarily wanting to be part of any kind of committees or coming to any public meetings. But they just simply wanting to be, in a very simple way that somebody explained to them that how the money is being used and how it's allocated, and then is that kind of ongoing dialogue that's sometimes missing. I think a lot of the policymakers, whether it's nationally or locally, somebody somewhere develop a plan first and then they consult. Very seldom is actually encouraging people to say, you yourself, you identify, and then we consult. So I think to change that dynamic, it requires a lot more work, because you do need to have some people on the ground to kind of help them to feel that they are able to have a voice, because it's not simply as just kind of inviting people in the meeting room. It needs more than that.
Okay, thank you. Paul?
Thank you. I think it's a really important question. And like I said at the end of my opening remarks, I think it's really important that it's not just governments alone that are orchestrating this kind of work. And I know even the convener will know from his work on the open government work when he was a minister that it's really important there is transparency around the budget, that there's accountability, but really importantly that there's participation. And I would say in terms of the third sector's role in shaping the Scottish budget is that it is extremely limited. The opportunities that we have are the opportunities that we have here today, right now in this committee room. And that's why we keep coming back when we're invited. But there is no discussion about what our priorities should be for the Scottish budget with colleagues in government, before the setting of the budget. So I think that's something that needs to be worked at. But back to your point about what's actually needed to get voluntary organisations and others involved and participating in deciding spending decisions and what's needed most. You can have policy that indicates that voluntary organisations should play a key role and there should be participation of voluntary groups and communities in setting the budget. But we know across Scotland that the biggest challenge is the implementation of policy relating to third sector involvement in partnerships and seeing that translate into practice. We hear from voluntary organisations all the time that the policies are there in terms of engaging with voluntary organisations and making sure they're part of shaping decisions. But actually there's a disconnect of what happens in practice. And I think that's really important that we look at that and we ensure that whatever we do to ensure greater participation in things like the Scottish budget, that we're looking at mechanisms that are holding government to account on how they're involving the third sector in shaping those decisions.
Thank you. And thanks for the reference to the Open Government. Open Government is one of the areas that I have worked previously with Councillor Everson on. So, Councillor Everson.
Yes, Convener, we've worked closely on many things in the past, I think, so it's good to see you again in this role. But yes, I think there's two levels of answer to this one about participation. Firstly, in terms of local government as a whole, working with the Scottish Government. And I think there's a real need to make sure that that local government voice is there right at the beginning of budget setting process as policies and ideas are being developed. We've seen the really positive impact on policy that can happen when that is in case. For instance, the early learning and childcare, the successful development of that, it was really much in partnership, you know, the voice of local government heard at the beginning, and we've got a good policy outcome as a result of that. I think it's crucial when the Scottish Government is setting the budget, it looks carefully at how things are going to be delivered so that any pitfalls, any issues can be ironed out, and we can really get that lens on equalities and human rights and make sure the delivery is going to work in the most effective way. So I would argue for greater transparency around budget setting in the same way that the other speakers have, and ask very much that it's best that we're involved at the beginning, because then we can help develop the best outcomes from the money that's available across Scotland. The second level of the answer, of course, is around our communities and how we involve our communities. And yes, we are committed totally to that 1% of participatory budgeting. We would like to see that across the whole of the public sector and not just for local government, but it's something that everyone should be delivering and empowering the communities to get involved, because that is the best way to understand what people want and how they want their services delivered. I totally understand the issues that Nina is raising and how, you know, we've got to make sure that our marginalised communities can take a part too. And that is our function as local government. We have to take responsibility for that role and ensuring that voices are heard across our communities and can be involved. And those that don't necessarily have the same tools as others to participate in the spending of money and the developing of local services, we need to ensure that we work to empower them. And that's a role that councils across Scotland take on through the citizens panels they have, the listening lived experiences groups they have, and the way they increasingly listen to local communities and work with them at a local level. So commitment to participatory budgeting, want to see it wider across Scotland and other bodies involved, and understand that our role is to help empower those communities to have that voice in what they're doing and participate in how money is spent and services delivered in their local area. Thank you.
Great, thank you. I think thus far all of the questions have been really, it's been really important to hear from all three witnesses. I think going forward that might not be the case. So if when members are asking questions, if they want to direct them at a particular panel member, then hopefully that way we'll manage to get through all of the areas of questioning that we have. Can I move to Karen Adam?
Absolutely. Thank you, Convener, and welcome to the panel. Good morning. And it is nice to see well-kent faces. So I'm going to direct my question to Alison Everson. And just touching upon and building upon what we've been speaking about already, the pandemic has made more stark some of the inequalities that we were already aware of. And, you know, there's numerous examples in terms of local authorities, increased requirement for social care, housing services, school meals, council tax relief funds, and even for domestic waste as more people worked from home. Virtually every area of local authority service was impacted by that change that we'd all experienced. So from a local authority perspective, in the context what
was known before and what is exposed now, really, in this post-lockdown world. How do you prioritise or at least focus upon that through that equalities lens? So really, going into a bit more detail about what you were saying earlier, what does that look like practically when it comes to that pre-budget planning?
Yeah, morning, Karen. Good to see you as well. I think you're totally right in what you're saying there, that the equalities have been exacerbated during the pandemic, and we've seen things through a closer lens. But they did exist beforehand, but they've come to light, and we have to respond to those inequalities as we see them, and we have to make sure that we address human rights, we address the needs of people right across our communities, and obviously that requires some different thinking. There's also not one answer to that question, though, because every authority across Scotland is different and they will be seeing needs in a different way, and they will be needing to respond in a different way. Maybe in one area it's housing is a particular need, and maybe in another it's leisure facilities for the mental health and well-being of the communities. So there is not one answer about how best to deliver that. And I suppose that comes down to the importance of giving the funding to local government to address the needs in their own particular community. How they find out about these needs is the ongoing work of local government, of course, in our areas through the various community impact assessments that are going on, the engagement with people who have lived experience, which is increasingly happening across our communities, but right at that local level. I know that in wards across Scotland as well, in individual council wards, through really small areas within that council, there's that kind of engagement going on, working with partners in the third sector too, to really understand the needs of that community and get to grips with what's going on. So processes will have to change as a result of this, but I think to enable them to change, that focus on the local is increasingly important, that emphasis on giving flexibility to local councils as well to spend the money is also increasingly important, so they can recognise that need and really address inequalities in their own area. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to take Maggie in, then I think Pam Duncan Glancy has some sups in this general area, but Maggie.
Thanks very much, and good morning and welcome to all the panel members this morning, and thank you for what you've told us so far. I want to just explore some of the progress and barriers a little bit more, and I suppose I would like to ask all of you this, but I hear what Joe said about timing, so I might focus in on Paul's response if that's okay. Paul, you spoke about the restrictions and the barriers around long-term funding, around the bureaucracy, around funding applications, that kind of thing. And in a previous life, I was very well aware of this, going back to the compact days of the 2000s. But I suppose linking those challenges and barriers to something that I think we can all agree we haven't made progress on enough, and that's prevention. And the work from the Christie Commission, and 10 years on from Christie, we're still not seeing that level of investment in prevention, never mind the sustaining of current services and full cost recovery and all of those elements. Can I ask you what is it that you and your members need to make sure that we can actually get a preventative spend as well as sustaining current ongoing services at using a full cost recovery model that is so important? Thank you.
I think voluntary organisations need to be funded and given the time to be able to come up with innovative ways of doing things. One of the biggest challenges that voluntary organisations face, we hear about long-term funding all the time, and absolutely that is essential. But I think one of the biggest challenges that organisations face is around a lack of unrestricted funding. Unrestricted funding is really vital in supporting organisations to be able to flex and to be able to change their services and adapt what they do based on the needs at the time. And we've seen through the pandemic that a lot of funding has been flexible, and it's worked really well, and it's something we hope that we can keep hold of. Like I say, flexible funding, when organisations apply for funding, they're doing so based on the need at that time, but needs change. Clearly, the pandemic is a very good example, but needs change, and organisations need to be able to flex and adapt. So that's one aspect. But I think in terms of building the capacity of voluntary organisations to be able to plan long term and to be able to contribute meaningfully in partnerships and in discussions like the one we're having today, it's absolutely essential that voluntary organisations are supported through core costs. They need to be fully supported in the delivery of the services and the projects that they run. I've heard before core costs being referred to by funders, mentioned no names, as dead costs. But they aren't. They're absolutely essential. And I think we've seen this move towards kind of projectization of funding, public sector or independent funders wanting to fund specific projects with specific outcomes. But there needs to be that infrastructure in voluntary organisations to be able to not only deliver those, but also look at the long term, look at replacement funding to sustain those services. And it's back to that point I mentioned at the start about causing more harm than good when you set up a project or a service for a year, that a year isn't long enough to meet the needs of those people you're trying to support, and then that service is yanked away. And I think not only has an impact on the staff of those organisations and on the service that individual is receiving, but I think it has probably a broader impact on their view of Scottish society and what their own government and governments are doing for them. So core costs cover things like IT, fundraising, HR. I think the fundraising point is really important because we've touched on that earlier on in the session. But I think it's investing in voluntary organisations' capacity to plan and contribute to long-term development and delivery of Scottish national priorities and local priorities. If you're funding organisations on an annual cycle and you're funding them for specific projects, they cannot contribute to long-term strategic discussions about how policies could be changed and how they could be implemented for more preventative reasons. And I think that organisations we speak to, one of the challenges that this committee and other committees and groups will find is that they won't hear from the organisations they need to hear from. You'll hear from people like SCBO, and I'm pleased you do, but the organisations you really need to hear from as well are ones that aren't able to contribute because their funding simply, they're there to deliver the service and they can't take any time away from delivering that service. So if you want voluntary organisations to deliver their skills, knowledge and expertise to shape policy and shape implementation, then you've got to invest in their capacity to be able to do that. I'm sorry, that's a long answer. But
No, that's helpful. Yeah,
possibly going to pick up on some other points we'll talk of later as well. Yeah,
not happy to hand over to Pam now.
Okay. Pam.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. I want to ask a question specifically about the rights of three groups of people and in two spending areas, so quite specific and probably directed, if it's all right, at Councillor Everson and at Paul Bradley, if that's okay. Firstly, in recent weeks, we've seen the extreme shortages of staff in social care that has resulted in some services having to be stopped, some people not being able to get the services they need, and some unpaid carers having to pick up the slack. That, at its very basic level, means that there are a large number of people in Scotland today not achieving the minimum core of their basic human rights. And so I just want to get a bit of an understanding about the impact that particularly Councillor Evans, the funding settlement for social care and for local government has on the recruitment crisis, the impact of increasing wages within the sector in terms of addressing that, particularly around the £15 an hour, and also the impact of doing so on the equality and human rights of disabled people and women. And to yourself, Paul, specifically about the ways in which the third sector have had to step in at times over the past year and for many years to provide essential services and your assessment of the funding settlement and what we could be doing in the budget to improve the human rights of the people I've mentioned, but also to make sure that we don't just meet the minimum core of basic human rights for these people, that actually we progressively realise their rights to an adequate standard of living and an independent life.
Alison, do you want to kick off?
Yes, thank you very much for that question. I recognise the scenario that Pam's describing there, so thank you for raising that. And the underfunding of local government over many years has had a huge impact on social care and other services. I think it's important to point out that, local government has actually put more money in proportionately from its budget into social care. So it's given added value to the money from Scottish Government from its budget to support social care, recognising that it's such a crucial area of local delivery. And this, of course, has been at the cost of other services like culture and leisure, which in a wider sense also have an impact on social care, on the needs of people receiving social care. It's important to see needs holistically as well. So underfunding has been a key issue. And there are fundamental issues in workforce planning as a result, yes, and that is something that we do need to address right across Scotland, how we look at the workforce, how we to ensure that the workforce is supported, it can be valued, and that it can be trained and developed in the appropriate way. And that's something that we'd welcome joined up thinking about the best way to take that forward, local government and Scottish Government working in partnership on workforce planning. And obviously there's other strands of work going on at the moment to look at that kind of aspect. We acknowledge during the pandemic in particular there were particular needs and some services were not able to be delivered in the way they had been before the pandemic, despite the fact that councils were so flexible and agile in their responses. And this again shows the importance of local delivery. We had people who normally worked in sports centres going to help deliver social care, for example. You know, that agility locally to make sure that the important things could be delivered as much as possible in an area with staff available. Because I suppose the key thing to remember is local government staff are not immune to the pandemic like anyone else. They also have to social isolate. They also have the issues with family life as well at this particular time. So that context is important. I think we've argued for a long time about wanting to value our workforce in general. We see the local government workforce as one workforce and would like to be able to value and support the one workforce of local government across the piece. And that parity across the workforce has been important to us. Now, you will appreciate that at the moment with the funding of local government, it's been very difficult to do that. And it comes back to that question about funding for local government and how that helps build the communities that we want to see built. If we are talking about a human rights approach, if we're talking about equalities, if we're talking about local government and the people that work for local government as being crucial to the delivery of that, now we've got to respond to that in our budget setting so people can be given that value, that training, that development, that support through their terms and conditions and other aspects of employment. That fair work agenda, we have to deliver on that, but that requires funding in itself to make that happen. So I recognise the situation you're talking about very much. Local government is there to support people across our communities and meet needs of people across our communities. The funding to do that is really important. Now, we've talked so far about how that can be done through the Scottish Government budget. It was also important to mention that giving local government the flexibility to raise its own finance would be a way to address this too. There's various ways to do that. We've talked before about tourist tax, which is one example of doing that in an area where it might be appropriate. But looking at the whole fiscal framework and how local government could be supported to also raise its own money to help deliver things like social care, because the chronic problem, the basic problem in social care is chronic underfunding, which also prevents things like that preventative agenda that's already been talked about. So I think that must be the key to your answer, but I will also praise everybody across local government who has done so much during the pandemic and throughout the time to support people across our communities have their basic needs addressed. Thank you.
Thank you. And Paul.
I know I probably have to be quick with this answer. And an SVO, we work with a range of intermediaries who are more specialised on health and social care. But I think it would be wrong to focus on this discussion and not bring up issues around procurement in social care. And obviously, it's an issue across the board. But again, time and again, we hear about the kind of shift towards tendering as a way to cut costs of services. And there's understanding in terms of that money has to be saved somewhere. And we've heard before in previous committee sessions that the local government and others will look to the voluntary sector where funding isn't ring-fenced to make those savings. But that shift towards procurement and towards contracts, largely those contracts are not favourable, by and large anyway, for voluntary organisations in terms of things like inflationary uplift and full cost recovery. But also the tendering process really pits voluntary organisations against each other. And it drives down the quality of services in favour of cost savings. And while some people would refer to it as the price war, and while there is that competition between voluntary organisations in social care and other areas, there's also great competition between voluntary sector providers who are trying to deliver services not for profit to improve people's lives and communities, and those services and those bids that are coming in from private sector providers too, who are able to undercut voluntary organisations through things like not paying the real living wage and so on. So these are big issues, and I think that in terms of what can be done, there'll be others more qualified to give more detailed answer, but I think that we need to ensure that procurement works and enables local voluntary organisations, particularly those smaller specialist organisations that have a key role to play but currently are kind of excluded from the tendering process because it is so, or either because the contracts are too large or because it's just a very timely and resource-heavy process. We need to see contracts that have fair work principles, inflationary uplift and full cost recovery. And I think one solution, a key solution in terms of supporting the development of contracts that work for both the public sector and for voluntary sector providers, is ensuring that voluntary organisations are part of designing those contracts and what's needed to actually deliver them in a meaningful way that's going to help people live a good life. And that doesn't just connect with social care, it's across the board in the voluntary sector. But I hope that's somewhat useful to your question.
Nina.
Yeah, I know that I wasn't invited to answer that question, but I really want to answer this question, not in terms of just kind of providing the basic care, because I think the moment, because all the issues that have been discussed, there seem to be the approach is like creating a priority group and just meeting the basic needs, i.e. having the carers going in to check on the person. But what we've been hearing is a lot of the disability groups in Fife, they're really worried about the closure of the daycare services. So when we're talking about procurement, we need to think beyond just personal care. People thrive by building social relationship with each other, but if that's lacking, then they might have somebody coming in to check that they're okay, but they're not having kind of this natural relationship with anybody else. They're not seeing anybody else. So we still need to not to take away those spaces where they bond with one another, where, you know, jobs also created because of those daycare services. So I think, I know that the local groups in Fife, they will be really annoyed with me if I don't stress that point that, you know, we need to think beyond just the kind of personal care. Think about the preventative stuff that's been going on for a long time and people being able to live their life fully, as mentioned many times here.
Thanks very much for that. And I thought you were going to want to come in on the question, particularly when the answers came in, but Pam was trying to appease me. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. In your statements, you talked about the challenges that you face, and Councillor Ellison talked about fair funding packages, and the whole idea of involving the community and ring fencing. So all of that you see as potential opportunities for you as organisations and individuals. But can I maybe ask what you would see as some of the specific and focused asks that you would like to see the Scottish Government looking at in specific areas? Are there any areas within the budget that you feel that are real priorities? And that could be about the charging and the revenue that you can manage to obtain, and also about how the budgets are processed, and also the timing. You've touched on all of that today about how you see that. So if I could get a short answer from all of you on some of that, that would be really helpful. Thank you.
OK. Nina, do you want to go first this time?
OK. The reason I say that it needs to be, is especially when we talk about equality and human rights, it needs to be ring-fenced, or having understanding that each local authority have to, if you go along the way of local authorities or key services nationally, they have to have an understanding that this money needs to be spent on equality and human rights, because otherwise they will just use the money for other things. If you don't you know, ring fence it, because my worry has always been, you know, if people say, oh, depending on the needs of the community. And again, we're talking about who has the louder voices, and very much the communities that we, like a Five Centre for Equalities, you're talking about people with disabilities, you're talking about a whole range of people who have been marginalised from the society. They're not going to have a voice in those talking about community needs. So I think if whatever the funding made available, whether to local authorities or to national services, that needs to be something tied along to that they had to demonstrate the commitment. And if anything, we've asked so many individuals in Fife, name one thing that you think that desperately needing investment, transport. I think that goes, you know, beyond all kind of rural or semi-urban areas, because this real lack of investment to take people to jobs, lack of investment to take people to where they want to study, and I think in Fife, it's like people say that it's easy for them to get to Edinburgh than from, Kirkcaldy to Kelty, you know. It's just we don't seem to design a system that help people to live their life, and I think if we can get that right, then that would be good. But I think it's about, but then that transport system is it needs to be accessible, you know, by so many different groups. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, I'll keep it short because there's a lot in that question, but I'm going to stick to the timely aspect that was in there. I've been meeting recently. I've met with about 20 or so, I think I said at the start, CEOs from different charities, just with like in-depth interviews to discuss the challenges. I think one of the biggest things, one of the key things that Scottish Government could do in terms of their funding for voluntary organisations is make sure, even if they can't go near multi-year funding, which they should do, but if they can't, make sure that there are timely decisions made on funding and that there are timely payments into those organisations' accounts. It is the number of organisations I've spoke to who are waiting to find out whether they've be funded for the next financial year in March, April, and sometimes May, and haven't got their funding into their bank account until maybe October, It's unbelievable. And I don't how organisations can ever play a key role in delivering services that are going to impact on people's lives in a positive way without that stability. I just can't see it. And I think another example would be Children and Families Fund. I'm not sure I've got that name completely spot on. But voluntary organisations are waiting 2 years on since they made those applications to find out what's happening with that fund. And they've been told that they will hear something in the autumn, and that's it. I don't know if they've heard anything yet, as we're now in the autumn. But organisations in that situation will need to take some tough decisions if a decision isn't forthcoming soon. They will have to put staff on redundancy notices. They will have to think about potential closure. One organisation I spoke to, I think that this committee could really make a good step forward in asking the Scottish Government to adhere to a clear timeline in terms of making funding decisions and then ensuring payments are received by organisations.
Thank you. Alison?
Thank you. I will here at this point take issue, I think, with the difference with what Nina has said, and I would not support ring fence funding. I think ring fence funding does not allow for local needs to be addressed in the appropriate way. I think the problem has been up till now that local government has not been empowered to spend the money flexibly in terms of local needs, and removing ring fence and trusting local government, empowering local government to spend the money appropriately in the area to meet local needs and engage with its citizens and residents across the piece, particularly those who are currently underrepresented, I think is a key answer for that. So would not support ring fence money anymore, but would instead support greater empowerment for local government and flexibility in how they spend the money. I think on specific asks, as again, we'll ask you to ask to end the council tax freeze. That benefits higher earners rather than the people across our communities with the greatest needs we should be supporting. emphasise again the need for multi-year funding to do that long-term planning as well, and allowing councils to make decisions for around things like setting planning and building fees as well, so that they can ensure full cost recovery to make sure that the money available locally is really supporting the people that need to be supported by it. Something we haven't mentioned to date is capital budgeting, capital funding. Now, this can also make a huge difference to our communities and the way councils can organise assets across an area to help meet equalities and human rights agendas as well. And, you know, the impact of capital budgets at the moment is crucial, and we should look at how that funding can be given to councils. As an employer as well, you know, it is important to remember that in many areas of Scotland, the council is the biggest local employer and has a huge influence in creating jobs, helping employability, and that way getting more money into the system locally to help address the human rights and equalities areas as well. So I think they are key issues I would bring forward. Also argue against pots of money in mid-year to fund particular policy priorities. That doesn't help strategic planning either. We need to have a longer term view. We need to have the budget settlement when the budget settlement comes, and therefore be able to make plans around that particular money as well. So I think that probably very quickly answers your questions. Alexander, thank you.
Thank you. Philip McGregor.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think that most of the areas that I was interested in have actually been covered. I was particularly interested in the home care aspect that Pam Duncan-Glancy talked about. So I won't ask the panel to go over that again, because I think there has been some clear answers given. But just to reflect as well that I think probably, you know, the number of home care queries over the last few months as a constituency MSP has been quite telling. So I do think that the any thoughts and suggestions that we've heard today about how we might be able to improve services here to meet human rights are welcome. I just do have one brief question to finish off, and it's for yourself, Paul, if that's all right. And it's something that came that was drawn to my attention, you know, in terms of, during the pandemic, there was a local organisation in my constituency who undertook a lot of work, who started up as a response to the COVID-19 pandemic and undertook a lot of work delivering food parcels and providing support to vulnerable people across my constituency area, and indeed they actually went over boundaries into other constituencies as well. And they done it just with a group of volunteers, and I think that the amount of work that they took on and potentially, you know, in a way saved the local authority doing was quite significant. You're talking about thousands and thousands of contacts that they had. And when I went out and spoke to the people there, they weren't receiving any funding. They weren't connected with the other voluntary organisations who had a network in place, and actually were finding it quite difficult to get into that network as well. And the amount that they were doing, they weren't really looking for any additional funding particularly. But I wonder, that's just one example in one constituency. Is that something that you've seen through the pandemic? And how do we make sure that, I suppose it goes back to that thing about the ring fencing. If you're talking about ring fencing, it might be all the organisations get it that are up and established, whereas a local authority, as Alison Evanson was saying, may be able to pinpoint an organisation like that. I wonder if you're able to have a wee comment on that. Thanks.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, during the pandemic, we've seen a whole host of organisations that have had to close their doors and have not serviced again. They've completely finished. But at the same time, we've also seen a whole range of groups and community groups and organisations set up, and that's one positive. And they've set up because there was a need. I think, you know, organisations were able to access a whole range of emergency funding during the pandemic, and we made that, working with government and others, local authorities and stuff, made that as simple as possible for organisations to access. But I think that there is a challenge in a way that we now have a lot of organisations or a lot of groups that have been set up based on need, and now they will need support in terms of if they are to sustain and find funding. You know, all the issues we've discussed about, it's funding is pretty much a profession in itself. Then those organisations are going to need to be supported to develop their constitutions, to secure funding, and really hold people's hands on that journey to ensure that that organisation or that group doesn't slip away based on the struggles they find in terms of accessing further funding and support. I think in terms of ensuring organisations can access that, clearly investment in infrastructure bodies, third sector interfaces in local authority areas is absolutely crucial. They provide the link into local authorities and to funding that's available to voluntary organisations. So it's absolutely crucial. And I'd just point members to the third sector interface networks manifesto that was published ahead of the most recent election as a really good source of information to look at.
Convener, because it's something that's been raised, mm-hmm. you know, several times, particularly by Nina and yourself, Paul, and your roles throughout this meeting. But actually, it's something, and I'm sure my colleagues will agree, is we hear all the time that thing about the funding the application process being a full time job in itself, and you know, I hear that all the time with organisations. Is that something that we need to address specifically? Then I know you've touched on it already, but I think the argument's mainly been that the funding process needs to be made more simpler. But would another way be is if there could be government or local authority support for organisations, or more support, should I say, because I know there is some support, to actually do the funding applications?
So I would say that we need to look at the experience of the pandemic. So if we look at what the committee heard back in 2019, all of that stuff is still relevant about applications, about the challenges that organisations face, and we've touched on some of that today. But I would say let's look at what happened during the pandemic, and it wasn't perfect, nothing ever is, but the way in which public sector and voluntary sector bodies and independent funders came together to set up things like a shared funding platform where data could be shared, information about where money was flowing could be shared. It was a single point of entry for organisations to access funding. I think that's the kind of thing that we need to be looking at to make it as simple and as easy as possible for organisations for other people to do the hard work in terms of navigating where those people should go in terms of specific applications and specific funds that are available. But it should be easier for the person or the organisation that's looking for funding. And I think we can look at examples during the pandemic, build on experiences with independent funders, the voluntary sector and government, and really make sure that we are trying to build something that's more, that's easier to navigate for organisations, either who are starting up, even those organisations that have been in the sector for a long time. I don't know if you want to say something, Nick. We were chatting about this beforehand.
Sorry,
it is very much what I'm wanting to add. There's a process before the funding that is good, presenting quite a lot of difficulties for a lot of groups, because in order to access funding, you need to be constituted, you need to decide what kind of body that you want to be that allow you to apply for fund, and you need to be registered with OSCAR. And a lot of these groups, they don't have the capacity to even get to that stage. So I mean, I was telling Paul this example that we've been given a small pot of money from National Lottery Community Fund to distribute to those small groups that you mentioned that happened during the COVID, who are not, may not be constituted, might not be have a OSCAR registered, and but then they just need a tiny little bit of money to kind of continue some of the work that they do. And so we have this local group that wanting to just organise meetup groups in Fife. And then they got back to us and say that they were told that they need to have a public liability insurance, and which they don't have, and it costs a lot of money to have that. Then who can pay for that? And so, I mean, as Fife Centre for Equalities, and I'm hoping that my board doesn't hear this, but then I'm using my chief executive hat to say that if that money is actually quite small, we might be able to do that, because we wouldn't want to give them a few hundred pounds, but then they can't use it simply because they don't have the public liability insurance. But I think it's about the stage before the even funding, that how unfair the whole system can be for groups that relying on just a bunch of really well-meaning volunteers.
Okay, listen, thank you very much. I feel that's going to be an area of questioning that Fulton might be pressing in other sessions that we have. Thanks all three of you for your evidence today and for taking the time to join us. That's been really, really helpful. I think we, again, probably could have spent the whole afternoon chatting with you. There's a lot of issues and your evidence has been so complementary between all three of you. So thank you so much for your time. I'll now suspend briefly to change witnesses. Okay, welcome back. We now move on to our second panel of witnesses, and I'm pleased to welcome Shona Robison, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and Scottish Government officials, Trevor Owen, Head of Mainstreaming and Strategy Unit, and Emma Harvey, Head of Finance and Business Support Unit, both from the Directorate of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights. Cabinet Secretary, do you want to make a brief opening statement?
Just very, very briefly, Convener. Good morning, everyone, and thanks for the invitation to give evidence today on the Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights budget as part of the pre-budget scrutiny process. As you're aware, COVID-19 has highlighted the deep-rooted inequalities that exist within our society, and it's vital that as we move to the next stages of our renewal and recovery work, that we use this opportunity to make fundamental and lasting changes to address these inequalities. Equality, inclusion and human rights continue to lie at the heart of our approach to budgeting. In forming spending plans, ministers must take into account the impact their decisions will have for equality considerations. The Minister for Equalities and Older People and I will continue to work closely with ministerial colleagues to support these considerations. Convener, I'm also pleased to note the committee has written to subject committees to consider the implications for equality and human rights on their own subjects as part of their pre-budget scrutiny, and this is genuinely cross-cutting, which remains everybody's business. Turning briefly to my own portfolio budget, in the 2021-22 budget, the Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights budget lines increased to £36.6 million. This was a significant increase of around 35% from the 2019-20 budget position, signalling the Scottish Government's commitment to this work. Since May, we've started developing a new five-year £10 million plan to tackle social isolation and loneliness, with £1 million in funding for organisations this year and the remainder over Parliament. And we've delivered the new Equality and Human Rights Fund, increasing the funding available by over £1 million a year to £7 million per annum over the next 3 years and supporting 48 projects across Scotland. And although I recognise this is out with this committee's remit, my portfolio also provides significant investment to tackle violence against women and girls and support refugees and asylum seekers. And I'm happy to go into detail of that during the session. The new streamlined funding streams will more closely align with our funding with the National Performance Framework outcomes, and will encourage and support partnership working to tackle some of the more entrenched issues of inequality across our society. I also welcome the committee's focus on human rights budgeting in its evidence sessions to date, and in our programme for government we committed to further embed equality and human rights within all stages of the Scottish Government's budget process, taking account of the Equality Budget Advisory Group's recommendations. EBAG presented ministers and the Scottish Government with a set of recommendations on equality and human rights budgeting earlier this year, and these are being considered as part of our ongoing work around budgeting. So I'm looking forward to working with the committee and look forward to your questions.
Thank you. And I'm going to go straight to Pam Duncan-Glancy first.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you all. Thank you for coming in and speaking with us. We've heard this morning from the from Councillor Evans, from COSLA, and also from the SCVO as well, about two particular areas that I wanted to ask a question on. At the minute, we're seeing a number of social care services being pulled as a result of the pandemic, but I think it's fair to say, due to pressures as a result of the pandemic, but I think it's fair to say that those particular pressures, or some of those pressures, existed long before the pandemic too. So I was wondering whether or not you would be able to outline what percentage increased investment you would think in social care would be needed in order to reach the minimum core, but also to progressively realise the human rights of disabled people, and in particular as well, in doing so, address some of the inequalities faced by women. And then, in additionally, in particular relation to your own budget line, do you believe that the Scottish Government is doing all it can with the powers it holds right now to alleviate the groups, disabled people, unpaid carers and women, from poverty? When do you think you intend to take control of full devolved benefits to ensure that these groups are not left behind at the hands of the DWP? So a lot in there, I recognise that, yeah. But being short of time, I wanted to get it all out.
Oh, OK. And if I don't manage to cover every single aspect, then I will write to the committee just capturing all of it. I mean, on the first issue of social care funding, And this is obviously an area of responsibility for Hamza Yousaf and Kevin Stewart. But you will be aware, obviously, Hamza Yousaf is going to make a statement that will, I think, outline some of the government's thinking in this regard. I think, the Scottish Government has been clear that we see part of the benefits of a national care service of being improving the terms and conditions of the workforce, which, as you pointed out yourself, is a predominantly female workforce. So I think that will help to address the inequalities and will help to improve the fair work agenda within that workforce. You talked about the benefits, the disability benefits, and you're right to say that, you know, this is the next big area of responsibility for Social Security Scotland. Obviously, you'll be aware that child disability payments being piloted and then will be rolled out from the 22nd of November. And of course, work is going apace on the adult disability payments. Now, you know, there are a lot of detailed considerations going on. SCOS have obviously been looking at the detail of these as well. And we want to make sure that we have a safe and secure transition of those benefits, but that we very quickly get into reviewing those once we have the case transfer underway, and looking at that and working with the committee and other stakeholders to make sure that we can make the improvements to those benefits. Now, I don't know if I've managed to kind of give a top response to the issues you've raised.
Ask a supplementary on that. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The area around the disability benefits, I think, is going to be really key. And yesterday, you'll be aware of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation's report into the experience of poverty in Scotland, and 100,000 of the families who are living in poverty have a disabled person in them. So I think there is now probably a more pressing need than ever to look at bringing forward the assessment of adequacy of disability assistance as well as eligibility. So is there any scope to move that forward, particularly given the number of staff that were added to Social Security Scotland last week? And also, have you considered looking at a supplement for the Scottish Child Payment in order to try and lift those particular families out of poverty?
So I think we should distinguish the two things. So we have the disability benefits that will transfer and will have to transfer essentially around similar criteria, albeit delivered in a very different way, for all the reasons that have been laid out, particularly to the Social Security Committee of this Parliament. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to transfer the benefits in the time frame allowed, and it would create a very confusing landscape if we had two different benefits working to do two different criteria. And I think we need to get the benefits transferred, and then we need to review the criteria and eligibility payments and so on. However, you mentioned the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, and you're absolutely right to say that the focus was very much on the six priority families. We know that 80% of children living in poverty are located within the six priority families. And of course, one of the priority families is where there's a person with a disability living within that family. Now, what I have said, I said this yesterday, a session I did with the GRF, is that the government's focus is very much around the other areas and game-changing policies that we can bring to the table alongside the Scottish Child Payment. And part of that is getting alongside the six priority families and identifying bespoke solutions for those families. So what is it that are the barriers for the family with the disabled person in the family that are preventing them either getting access to work or access to other areas and services and supports that could improve their lives? So I want to do, that's really the area that the government is focusing on at the moment. And once we have identified how we're going to do that, then I'm very happy to come back to the committee with that information. But that is very much our focus, because we know that can have a huge impact on child poverty if we get that right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you very much for coming along this morning, Cabinet Secretary. I want to touch on a couple of areas. One, you mentioned the Equality Budgetary Advisory Group report and the recommendations in your opening remarks. And I wonder if you could just say a little bit more about how you see progressing those recommendations, how that, some of that work is going, and particularly, I suppose, how those recommendations are allowing us to hear the often ignored or easy to ignore voices and more marginalised community voices in discussions and priority setting of budgets. And I'll come back to a couple of other issues.
Yeah, well thanks for your question. I mean, the EBAG recommendations made earlier this year are really important. And in the Programme for Government published last month, we made a clear commitment to further embed equality and human rights within all stages of the Scottish Government's budget process, taking into account the Equality Budget Advisory Group's recommendations. So the recommendations from EBAG were shared with me when I came in to post back in May, and then were published late, just a couple of months after. And we've been giving these careful consideration, including as part of the forthcoming budgetary cycle and as part of our longer term budget improvement and equality and human rights mainstreaming work. And I've agreed to renew the mandate of EBAG for a further year to allow further development of our collective thinking, and I plan to meet with the chair, Professor Angela O'Hagan, in early November to discuss the work of EBAG and their recommendations further. And thereafter, we'll seek to set out our thinking on the next steps in spring of next year, and I'd be happy to update the committee at that time. You'll be aware that the recommendations were presented under four themes, which were improving processes, communications, organisation and culture, knowledge and understanding. So, you know, a lot to get to look at, but happy to come back to the committee with detail.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that. I suppose one of the areas around participation and engagement, one of the reasons why that's so crucial, is to better understand budget priorities as we look ahead. And one of the things we heard from the panel just prior to this panel was the importance of long-term prioritising, so people understood what was coming and could plan effectively for you know, beyond just the annual cycle, or realistically what it is 3 months setting a project up, 6 months doing the project, then 3 months trying to scrabble around finding money for the next year again. I was wondering how you see Equalities as allowing us to get at some of the issues within that sort of planning and strategic work, and whether we need to at the same time take very seriously some of the I think quite significant asks from local government, from the third sector and elsewhere, around understanding the core costs that are very much a part of sustaining the work that both local government and the third sector does to deliver services across various people's remits, not only your own.
Yeah, well, first of all, just to say I do understand the very real point made by third sector organisations that they would want a multi-year funding in order to be able to plan their work over the long term. I have a lot of sympathy for that. I guess the difficulty is if the Scottish Government is working on a kind of one-year budget because the UK Government is working on a one-year spending review and one-year budget, it makes that very difficult to give certainty because we don't have the certainty. But we've made a commitment over a number of years that we want to try and work towards that because it does allow longer-term planning, and I absolutely understand and agree with that. I mean, in terms of the strategic work, I mean, I think it's really work in progress, I think, of embedding equality and looking at all of what we do through an equality lens and a human rights lens. It's work in progress. I think we've got a lot better at doing it. We've got a lot of expertise now, but there's work to be done, and I think EBAG really showed where the perhaps weaknesses are that need to be worked on, and you know, we will constantly try to improve, and hopefully when I, you know, in the March of next year, when we hope to be able to say more about this, we can make some further improvements still.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Karen.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. My question is in regards to data and analysis for human rights budgeting. I'd like to highlight that we're at the beginning of Black History Month, and throughout the pandemic, BAME people have been acutely affected by pre-existing inequalities across a huge range of areas. As the pandemic progressed, many of these underlying inequalities made the impact of the pandemic far more severe for BAME people. I'd like to ask what your views are on the quality of data and equality characteristics, and what improvements are planned in the light of forthcoming human rights obligations, for example, increasing sample sizes of data on specific groups, such as particular vulnerable and minority groups.
Yeah, I mean, you make a good point. We are with the Scottish Government and the agencies across Scotland that we have responsibility for collect, analyse and publish evidence and analysis by equality characteristic across a wide range of policy areas. And there are many barriers and challenges to collecting, analysing and reporting equality data. Despite improvements in recent years, there are still gaps in the equality evidence base. In April this year, we launched the first phase of our Equality Data Improvement Programme to take action to make equality evidence more wide-ranging and robust. A stronger and more complete equality evidence base will help to support the collective effort across the public sector and make sure that the requirements of the public sector equality duty are fulfilled. So that programme will be undertaken over the next 18 months, and I am hopeful of major improvements flowing from that. You mentioned one of the issues was about sample size. The first phase of the improvement programme comprises a series of projects that will focus on the process elements of equality data collection, including sample size. So that's in the early phase of the improvement programme. And, you know, again, I am happy to, make sure we keep the committee abreast of developments, specifically recognising data gaps regarding ethnicity. Our immediate priorities plan for race equality, which was published the 14th of September, so just last month, has at its heart the data improvement and systemic change recommendations made to us by the expert reference group on COVID-19 and ethnicity. So we absolutely recognise that. So a lot of improvement work going on, and we're happy to keep the committee updated.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Organisations like COSLA and many from the third sector have raised some issues with reference to the budget process itself. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what kind of scope for changes to the budget process are being thought about in the reflections from COSLA and the third sector, and how we, with the new human rights landscape, how changes will happen within that will handle and process the budget? And also, can I touch on the national framework, performance framework, and will things need to be revised within that context, within the budget itself?
Well, I think taking the last two points first, I think we're always constantly evolving and looking at ways of improving. And obviously the human rights budgeting is an area that is a very, very strong focus at the moment. Early days, but very much a commitment to get that right. So as you can imagine, I spend quite a lot of time speaking to COSLA, and the budget generally and finances is, I probably can't think of a meeting where that wasn't one of the issues that we discussed. I think COSLA would probably want as early engagement as possible and as much joint working around areas of priority. So if you take COVID recovery, which is going to obviously be at the heart of the budget, I mean, discussions have been going on with COSLA for quite some time, for months, around essentially a joint approach to COVID recovery. They've been involved in all of the discussions, which is quite right and proper. I would, whether that's different from other budget setting processes, I'm not sure, but I would say that this time, because of the focus on COVID recovery, COSLA, the involvement of COSLA in all of these discussions around strategic priorities and therefore the funding of them, has been very much at the centre of that, as you would expect.
And the third sector, the involvement?
Yeah, sorry. So the third sector, we could probably get better at trying to involve the third sector. But the third sector is a big sector, ranging from big strategic national organisations through to very small local organisations. So our engagement around the budget is more likely to be with the more strategic, larger organisations, by the very nature of budget processing. I think simplifying the budget and making it more accessible helps third sector organisations to be able to see the budget process, but also just how the budget, how it works and how it hangs together, what it looks like. I think we've improved over the years at simplifying that process. I don't know if Trevor, would you like to add anything just about the third sector involvement in?
I don't have anything particularly to add, to just echo what the Cabinet Secretary has said, that we obviously seek to, you know, engage with the third sector. And I think certainly as we're going through the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget analysis statement, we equally encourage and working across different portfolios, likewise for that engagement to be happening across different portfolios as well, and to seek to deflect that in the Equality and Fairer budget statement when it is published. So hopefully when that is published, it'll set out some of that thinking. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, for allowing me to have a supplementary on that. We heard this morning, as I said earlier, from SCVO, and you'll be aware that in their evidence to this committee, they said that they had asked the previous committee in 2019 to make significant changes around the way that they fund the organisations, including giving much more notice and certainty, and around the decision-making. I think they've said that so far the response of the government is underwhelming and with insignificant advances. Could the Cabinet Secretary at this point provide an update on what consideration you've given to those requests from 2019? And would you also consider, I was quite surprised to hear, that a sector with over 100,000 staff and a £6 billion turnover wasn't featuring in the Scottish Government's economic strategy. So I wonder if you could undertake to make a representation to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance to address that.
So on the last point, that issue has been raised with me directly around the third sector having a seat at the table around the economic strategy. So, I mean, that remains under discussion. I think that the role of the third sector, not least in COVID recovery, is fundamental. And in my discussions with them, I've made that point that is recognised by the government. The terms of the request from 2019, I think I might have to write to the committee about that, obviously a bit before my time, but I'm happy to write to the committee just in terms of updating what has been done since then, if that's okay.
Emma.
All right, okay, thanks, Emma.
That's helpful. in terms of what we've done within this portfolio in response to that, the new Equality and Human Rights funding streams committed to a 3-year period of funding in an attempt to give that level of continuity for organisations. We also opened it up to ensure that we were providing core support to organisations as well, so it wasn't just projects, and giving organisations the flex to choose how they what they bid for and how they wanted to use money that they were coming from, recognising that project funding without core support for organisations isn't particularly helpful for them. And that was on as a direct result of that, the evidence that the predecessor committed to this one took under the last one. As I say, there were a few more bits and pieces that we did, and I can write to you with a more fuller answer on that. But it definitely played in strongly to how we developed the Equality and Human Rights funding stream. We also did a number of sessions with organisations that we funded to get their feedback on what was helpful for them, and again attempted to add that flexibility in on the back of what we were hearing from our funded organisations. It's early days in terms of how well that worked, and we will be looking at that as we go through this period of funding to see whether they were the right adaptations and whether there's more that we can be doing for the next round and feed that through.
Great, thank you. Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask a wee question that was following on from the last panel that we had, and I don't know if you had a chance to see it, Cabinet Secretary, but and it's following on actually from the last line of questioning there as well, just about the funding streams that are open to voluntary organisations. And we heard from Paul Bradley in the last session quite clearly that, you know, that during COVID these were streamlined more and that was found to be helpful. But also, even just going back more historically than that, I think that we all recognise that voluntary organisations can sometimes have difficulty accessing the funding because they don't have somebody to do the job of doing the applications. I wonder if that's something that you're considering taking forward through budget processes, and, you know, what impact it might have if more smaller organisations are able to access some funding.
I think the first thing to say is that obviously there was a lot of interest in the equality and human rights funding, and more interest than could ever have been funded. We have to be honest about that. So we obviously have an independent process for assessing applications, and I think there's been a shift to try and make sure that national funding, if you like, is going to organisations that are quite strategic in nature. So, which then, I guess, your question is, well, what about the local smaller organisations? And I think there is a tension there. I think we would see very small local organisations perhaps even funded in a different way, and that we would deliver the Scottish Government funding to more strategic organisations. And that is not going to that is going to be a challenge, obviously. I don't know if you want to. Sorry.
Excuse me. Again, in the shift that we've attempted to make was to align the funding more closely with the national performance outcomes. To try and see that to get a bigger shift really in what we're trying to achieve with the equality and human rights funding. I think an unintended consequence of that has been that some of the more smaller organisations perhaps did find it more difficult. We did put in support through our funding partners to support organisations, and I know they ran a number of workshops and so on to talk through organisations how to apply and so on. But as I say, as we're now moving into more of a kind of delivery phase on that, I think that's definitely one of the things that we'll look for as to how well that worked, how that support was received by organisations. Was it the right kind of support? And look to see what lessons we can learn from that, from our funding going forward. But as the Cabinet Secretary said, it is always a tension between trying to focus budget on organisations and projects that can really shift the dial in what we're attempting to see in terms of outcomes, and also providing support for more local organisations.
Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Joe.
I'm going to try and pick up on, in some ways, the extension of what Fulton and McGregor was asking there, but to draw in a couple of other areas that I'm interested in exploring. We've heard, I suppose the first thing is to recognise, and Cabinet Secretary, you already have done in your earlier remarks, that this committee, never mind the Parliament as a whole, is at the beginning of you know, trying to understand how we do better both equalities and human rights budgeting across the board. And I suppose one of the obligations that we have, and I think the Scottish Human Rights Commission said, you know, they put it as, is the budget as big as it could be? So we have an obligation to maximise the size that our budget can be in order to deliver the kinds of things we want to deliver. So I've got a question, I suppose, around the Scottish Government's approach to tax and to other revenue raising powers that we have. I know we have the consultation at the moment is open on tax policy and budget policy. But can you say a little bit, or if you're in the position to say a little bit about how we can make sure that we actually get the budget to be as big as we possibly can, either through taxation or through other revenue raising powers? How are we doing in that work, especially with a human rights lens? And I suppose that the point of all of that then is to, coming back to the MPF outcomes, if we are looking at long-term long-term outcomes rather than annual or even three-yearly outcomes, how do we make sure that we can do this in a way that allows us to address, I think something that we can all recognise has been a, not necessarily a failing, but we've not gone as far as we would have liked to in the last 10 years since Christie on prevention.
Yeah, I think there's definitely more work to be done as per the Christie recommendations, at focusing more resources upstream in terms of prevention. Absolutely agree with that, but it's not the easiest thing to do, and we need to find ways of, not least through COVID recovery, to try and work with organisations, work with local government, to look at how that can be done, because we know obviously the spend is more effective in that space. I mean, you asked a number of questions around, I mean, the size of the budget, and I mean, essentially, these are, you know, decisions for government around the balance of the budget, and, you know, decisions about taxation in Scotland, at least to the extent such powers are currently within devolved competence, need to be informed really by an understanding of the resources needed to address areas of human rights deficiency or weakness. And I guess taxation is one of the principal means of ensuring that those resources are available. But in terms of COVID recovery, there is a balance to be struck of revenue raising, but also supporting businesses to recover and communities and families to recover. You'll see from our spend of through the COVID period, £2.5 billion of expenditure on supporting low-income households, and that's been a deliberate policy decision, obviously, to recognise that the COVID impact has not been equally felt. And by recognising that, that means you then have to act in a particular way in following through your policy and your budget decisions. So through the COVID recovery strategy, which is going to be very closely aligned to the budget going forward, I think you would expect to see more of that cohesive thinking across decisions that will be made. And tough decisions are always having to be made by government, and particularly around budget. There's never enough money to do absolutely everything that we would want to do. There never has been. And therefore, decisions have to be made. So you have to be more strategic. And the task that the Cabinet has been set on collectively we've set it for ourselves, is around what more can we do in the area of tackling child poverty. to, if everything's a priority, nothing's a priority. So we've had to be very clear about what the priorities are for government and therefore for the budget going forward. And that I hope will be clear once the budget process is properly underway.
Thank you.
Alexander Stewart.
In the programme for government, Cabinet Secretary, there's lots of discussion about participation and in ensuring that we get the democratic participation across the country and across the areas. So can I ask and tease out, what will the Scottish Government then do to ensure that it increases the level and also the quality of participation within the budget process?
Yeah, well, you'll be aware that EBAG, one of the EBAG recommendations state that public participation in formulating budget commitments and ensuring the integration of lived experience of policy decisions is essential. And I think a key aspect of equality and human rights budgeting is transparency of the budget process and documentation and the ability for people to engage and understand the budget, because, you know, it's quite a complex set of processes. It's complex for ministers, let alone folk who have maybe not been through that process before. So we recognise that there is work to do to improve both transparency and participation in the budgeting process. And as part of our response to these recommendations, we're going to be considering how best that's achieved, through what routes, as part of the wider objective to make Scottish fiscal information more accessible and understandable. The Fiscal Transparency Programme is intended to help with the publication of timely information in an accessible way, for example, using more data visualisations, infographics, open data, with clear explanations of the context. And that approach is intended to support improved understanding of how the Scottish Government's budget is allocated and spent, and thereby improving scrutiny by external and internal stakeholders. So, you know, work in progress, but I think we recognise that there is more to do. There are examples of good practice elsewhere in the world that we've been looking at, and, you know, we just need to keep the improvement side going on that.
Okay, thank you. Well, thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. I think that's committee members content for now. We've got other business to cover, so thank you for making it through the session without having a coughing fit. There was obviously one or two pieces where you said you would write to the committee, so we look forward to receiving that and being kept up to date on the other matters that you've talked about. So thanks very much, and we'll now move into private session.